Welcome back, everybody. Episode 25. We're going to be talking about Chiefs packages. We're going to be talking about what they are, what goes into them, how you construct those and put those things together, and then how you submit them. And then I also got something else that I'm really excited about. I got some perspective from a board member. There's a lot of misinformation, and this is the reason why I wanted someone with actual board experience to validate what I'm going to talk about on this podcast. So what I did is I reached out to a mentor of mine who is a retired 30-year command master chief. He was a chief of the boat on submarines, and he sat both the chief's board and the senior chief's board. So he selected people to chief, he selected people to senior chief, and he went through this outline for me and validated the information. And then he also shared with me some really, really great gouge on not just chief's packages, but how they're viewed by the board and then the actual process of grading and selecting chief's packages and selecting people to chief. So I'm going to share all of that with you in this podcast. I'm really excited to get this one started. And so we're going to do that. And there's a lot of tribal knowledge, as I mentioned before, misinformation and speculation as to what should be in a chief's package. And it turns out there's a book for that. Knowing the policy, like we always say, going to the book, reading the book, and following that guidance is how you, the board eligible sailor, gets selected by the board. So when I was coming up, I remember furiously searching for every scrap of information I could find on how to promote. I asked people, I read instructions, I Googled it, everything I could think of. And this led me to message boards and Facebook groups and speculations and rumors and guesses and essentially misinformation. I started to question the book, which I had read. I started to focus on the wrong things. I started to believe the wrong things about what I needed to be doing. And specifically, the construction of the Chiefs package. I literally spent time stressing over whether I could or should use a paperclip. Like the use of a paperclip would piss off some Master Chief so bad that I would get blacklisted forever and I would never make Chief. It was ridiculous. And I wasn't the only one doing it. So I'm going to do my best to dispel some of that and guide you through the process by the book of how to construct and submit this important piece of your career progression. All right, so let's start peeling this back, right? So what is a Chiefs package? We all hear about it, but what is it really? A Chiefs package, also known as you, the member's letter to the board. Okay, the letter to the board is your only authorized correspondence to the board, to the selection board. This is your only opportunity to communicate any information to the board. There used to be the ability for your command to communicate an award or significant qualification or achievement via naval message after the package deadline, but before the selection board convened. And people still talk about this as if it's the case. This is no longer the case, which I'll get into when we move on to the references. But to get an idea of what this letter to the board looks like, first, get yourself to the Navy Personnel Command or MPC's website. Okay, and go to the boards page. It's one of the first tabs on the left at the top of the page. This is the most up-to-date source of information on how to construct and submit your package. And it'll also guide you to where we always begin, which are, you guessed it, right? The references or the book. So there's several references, and it's especially important in this scenario because of all the misinformation. Normally, we start with the book, which in this case would be the Navy Advancement Manual. But like I said about that correction to it, that comes via naval message. And so we're going to start with the NAV admin. All advancement cycles begin with a NAV admin. You can find it on Navy Personnel Command's website under Reference Library. Then you go to Messages and then finally to NAV admins. And then you go find the one that's specific to your cycle. When the NAV admin is released, it contains a wealth of information for all cycles, so any advancement cycle. In the case of the Chiefs Board, it has significant and important information that affects you, beginning with the timeline. In paragraph 2 of the NAV admin, specifically for Chiefs, for the Chiefs Selection Board, and then in paragraph 2, you're going to find the timeline. It's laid out in very explicit detail, and the most important date that you want to find there is the deadline for your package submission. Take note of this because it has to be there by the deadline. And they get so exact with their information that it's down to the time zone and time that emailed packages must be submitted or when your mailed package has to be postmarked. So read that, make note of that, put an alarm in your smartphone, whatever you need to do to remind you so that you don't get past that deadline, because if you do, they will not accept your package. Paragraph 5 is also equally important as it provides detailed instructions on reviewing your record as well as the ways you can submit your package to the board, which board number you are submitting it to, etc. Take the time to run through this message with a highlighter. Make notes, right? Write in the margins, okay? There's a lot of information that's very important to you constructing your package, properly reviewing your record, submitting your package, etc. This is the point of origin for all the other information. So you want to start here. I'll cover submitting your package and the methods for doing so in detail later, so just stay with me, okay? Next reference, Navy Advancement Manual, Buper's Instruction 1430.16 series. The Advancement Manual has a lot of great information in it. This can also be found on NPC under Reference Library, then you go to Instructions, and then Buper's Instructions, and then you'll find it under the number I just mentioned. Generally, I would tell you to start here, but as we mentioned previously, the Nav Admin supersedes this instruction. There is new information in the Nav Admin every time, and it specifically calls out the specific information regarding a command's ability to submit a message to the board on your behalf. It's not the case, and it specifically says that it supersedes reference A, which is the Advancement Manual. So the Nav Admin is the most current. However, there is really, really great information in the Advancement Manual. You need to get in this book. Chapter 12 is entitled Enlisted Selection Boards. And in this chapter, you will find things like the composition of the board, how quotas are determined, and particularly paragraph 1204, documents considered by the board. Want to talk about clarity on what they can see? It's all spelled out right here. So all that confusion, I think they can see incepts and I think they can see all the... stop it. Read the book. Chapter 12, paragraph 1204 specifically. This paragraph references exactly what is considered, which I'll delve into in a more detail next. What the board can see is your official military personnel file, or OMPF, your personnel service record, or PSR, and your letter to the board, or your chief's package. That's it. Again, I'm going to get into more detail on that in a second. So the last reference they reference in Chapter 12 is the Milper's Man article, which is Milper's Man 1070 TAC 080, and the title of it is Official Military Personnel File. This is important because it references field codes in the Advancement Manual about what the board reviews, and those field codes are directly related to documents in your OMPF that the board will review, and these codes are 30 through 38. The Milper's Man article is going to break it down in detail what these are, and I'm going to read 30 through 38 for you. So field code 30 is procurement, contracts, enlistment, and re-enlistment documents. For example, service agreements and statements of understanding. 31, classification and assignment, history of assignments, miscellaneous correspondence on classification and assignment. 32, administrative remarks, entries required for permanent retention. 33, separation and retirement. So this is a long description of DD-214, certificate of release or discharge from active duty, DD-215, correction, DD-214, so on, keeps going, separation orders, reserve retirement, etc. Okay, so separation and retirement documents. 34, miscellaneous professional service history. All the stuff about when you first came in the Navy. So record of military processing, drug and alcohol abuse statement of understanding, key employee determination, miscellaneous correspondence concerning professional service history. 35, enlisted performance documents. So performance evaluations, for example, fitness reports, service member rebuttal, letters of explanation, performance evaluation correspondence. 36, training and education. So NAVPERS 1070/604, enlisted qualifications history. NAVPERS 1070/881, training, education, and qualification history. Language proficiency test, college transcript, and diploma. Completion certificates for courses not documented on NAVPERS 1070/604 or 1070/881. 37, decorations, medals, and awards. Personal award citations, for example, NAVPERS 1070/880, awards history, entitlement letters, and weapon qualification letters. 38, adverse information. For example, unauthorized absence in hands of civil authorities, court memorandum, punitive letters, drug and alcohol abuse report, civil conviction, probation report, and adverse case files. All right, now that we've finished off all the references, because that was all the field codes that they can review in your OMPF, and we finished off all the references, I want to talk about what the board can actually see, which I'm sure is killing you. We're going to get into detail about what they can see. This is what wraps so many people around the axle and causes so much unnecessary stress for board-eligible sailors. Let's provide some clarity here. The Chief Selection Board can see your OMPF, field codes 30 through 38, your PSR, which is your personal data summary, and your performance data summary, or performance summary data, excuse me, and your letter to the board. and whatever you send as enclosures to that letter of the board, which composes your package. That's it. That's all they can see. They cannot see anything else. They cannot see your insips. They cannot see your prims. They can see nothing else. Okay, and I know a lot of people think that they can see insips, and they get all these rumors, and oh, they can see prims, and blah, blah. No, they can't. No, they cannot. All they can see is your own PF, your PSR, and your package. The end. So if you want them to see it, knowing what they can see now, if you want them to see it, it goes in your package. You will consistently hear the advice given that it's your package. And that is absolutely true. If you want the board to see it, put it in your package, period. There are limiters, right? Like, don't submit redundant information, things that are already in your own PF. Avoid ridiculously long documents if you can. But at the end of the day, if you believe the board should consider it in deciding whether your name ends up on that list, send it in your package. So now let's break it down by each viewable category by the board, okay? So own PF. It is your responsibility to review it. Review your record. If you do not know where your own PF is, which I sincerely hope is not the case, you will find it at Bupers Online or BOL. It's CAC login required, and you'll go in and use the field codes as a guide, 30 through 38, to scrub your own PF. Okay, and you need to do a couple of things. You need to A, make sure everything that is supposed to be there is in fact present. So awards, evals, etc. Use those field codes. If not, then it's an enclosure to your package. But don't stop there. Take that document that's missing from your own PF to your personnel folks and get it in your own PF. Fix your record. There's absolutely no reason you should have like 30 enclosures in your package. Recognize it early by scrubbing your record and fix your record. And then B, make sure everything that's there is supposed to be there. So if it's not yours, get rid of it. I used to have another guy's evals in my own PF, and luckily I caught it back when we were just transitioning from paper to electronic records. Review all the field codes to ensure no one's adverse eval or mass documents are in your record. And it happens. If it is, and you can't feasibly get it fixed before package submission, that is what your package is for. So your letter to the board, that's something you can explain in paragraph 2 in your letter to the board. Okay, explain that this document is there, that it is not, in fact, you, and that you're working to fix it. And that is sufficient notification to the board to discard that document from their grading of your package. Okay, and if you don't know how to do this, there are templates on the NPC boards page. One is for just a standard letter with enclosures, and then one is for a letter with enclosures and paragraph 2, an explanation of something, like you found some information in your service record that's not yours, or you're missing an eval, it's in there, and you know you're working to fix it. Those are the examples, and you'll see that in the template, and if you have questions about how to do that, which we'll explain a little bit later, talk to your personnel folks. Okay, next, PSR and specifically eval continuity. If you haven't heard about eval continuity, pay very close attention. So the PSR, this is a quick reference for the board members to get the performance data and awards info for you specifically. It's fairly straightforward when you look at it. Again, bring any errors you see to the attention of your personnel folks. This is located on BOL. You will see a link that says ODC PSR OSR. You're going to click on that link, and then it's going to have three links. One's going to be personnel data summary. That's something you need to click on and take a look at, and it's exactly what it sounds like. It's just a data summary on you as an individual service member. And then there's a second link and a third link, and you'll see pre-1993 and post-1993, I think. And I don't have that in front of me, so you know, check me on that. But you want the post-1990 whatever, right? You know, pretty much all of us that are eligible for Chief, if not all of us. I can't imagine there's someone that came in pre-1993 that's just now eligible for Chief, but you want the third link, and that's going to be your PSR. That's the PSR they're going to be looking at. So you want to click on that and take a look at that, review that for accuracy. Next, on BOL, you will see a link for CCA/eval/FITREP reports. Okay, you want to click on that link. Next, you will see a link for Performance Evaluation Continuity Report. Click here. This report should show unbroken dates listing all your performance evaluations, and at the bottom under missing periods, it should read no missing periods. If it lists a missing period or a gap in your eval continuity, you need to address that rapidly. Later on, when I read the retired CMC's feedback, he specifically calls out that he has seen missing evals or eval continuity gaps prevent someone from selection because it basically creates an unknown and they're not going to gamble that that's not an adverse eval, okay? So the board looks at the last 5 years, and again, one of the CMC's recommendations is go back at least 6 years just to be safe. But the board looks at the past 5 years of evals unless a tie exists, in which they'll go back as far as they need to break the tie, right? But they're primarily, the ties are rare, and they're primarily going to be looking at 5 years back, okay? So your evals need to be present in order for them to do that. So identify the period, get out your I Love Me binder if you have a gap, and take that hard copy of that eval to your personnel office to fix it and submit that missing eval with your package with an explanation on your letter to the board, okay? And that should fill that gap. You should have no issues because they will have all of the evals available to them because they can look at your own PF for everything else because you scrubbed it and you made sure all your evals are there. And then the one that was missing is present in your letter to the board. Now, the letter to the board, your letter to the board is just that. It's a properly formatted letter addressed to the selection board for which you are being considered. So if you're not familiar with SecNav Manual 5216.5, the Navy Correspondence Manual, this is an example of a moment in time where you should be. There's a reason I brought it up in the last episode about the correspondence and how being able to properly format it and properly communicate to something important like a selection board, why this manual is valuable to that. You're going to properly format a letter, which is Navy correspondence. There's also, as I previously mentioned, two example templates on the NPC boards page. So make sure you're taking a look at that and it'll get out crayons and it explains exactly how they want it formatted. Your letter should list all of your enclosures. It should have your name and full social and be addressed to the correct board number, which you'll find in the nav admin. And it needs to be signed. It needs to have your signature on there. They will not accept an unsigned letter to the board and package. Okay. All right, so now we know what it is, right? We've broken down what they can look at, okay? So what goes in your package? This is another thing people just freak out about. What goes into your package? There's three components that I'm gonna break down right now. The first one is the letter, okay? Because your package consists of a letter and enclosures. So the letter itself is that properly formatted correspondence that I just talked about. You need to utilize your personnel folks to help you format it, okay? Because I don't expect you to be some high-level expert at formatting correspondence. I'm pretty good at it, and I get into correspondence manual a lot, and I still have my ship's yeoman look at it, okay? Because that's what they do for a living. They're subject matter experts on correspondence, so have them take a look at it. And then follow the very detailed instructions in all of the references and ensure you sign it, okay? It's very simple. It's just a letter. Then there's enclosures to your letter to the board. Your enclosures are what make just a letter into your package. Your enclosures are what you want the board to see, and this can be anything. It could be an eval or an award that are not in your record yet, okay? It could be a qualification. It could be a certificate or a degree, a professional certification, a report from INSEPs. This one's big. So they can't see INSEPs, but you can run reports and get things like your training, education, and qualification history, NAVPERS 1070/881. It will generate the actual form for you. You can print it out, verify to be a true copy from your personnel officer, done. Submit that as an enclosure, and it'll have those qualifications or education data or training or whatever that you want the board to see. It's important that each enclosure is legible. It displays your full name, your full social upper right corner, and enclosure number in the lower right corner. The full social and enclosure number and the way this is filled out, Navy Correspondence Manual. To how to format the enclosure page, and then your social goes in the upper right hand corner. Like if you've ever had to submit an award to get it inputted into your own PF, and you have to put your social in the upper right hand corner, same concept. Your name is displayed on the award certificate already, and then in the lower right hand corner, enclosure number. Okay, and then if there's multiple pages to that enclosure, you start numbering them at page two. Again, get in the correspondence manual. It'll help you greatly, and if nothing else, talk to your personnel people, have them look at your package before you submit it, or have any chiefs look at it because they've done this before and they apparently did it correctly because there weren't anchors to work. The last part I want to talk about, this is a controversial topic, I would say. So it's called a career summary letter. It's It's one of those things, I don't know where it came from. I don't know who invented it. I've heard wildly varying opinions on the career summary letter. It got my attention when I was still wading through all this tribal knowledge. And I'll tell you that I have, on numerous occasions, including the one that promoted me to senior chief, submitted a career summary letter to a selection board. And I want to very clearly and definitively state that I do not believe that this had any real effect on my being promoted. And you'll hear later that neither does the board member that sat the board who has seen packages with both, right? I do think I probably made some board members' job a little bit easier. I don't know. According to my mentor and the guy that, the command master chief that sat those boards, he said it's not really necessary. They're reviewing a lot of packages each day. So if I can make it a little easier for them to review my record, I've helped them out. I've helped myself by potentially ensuring there's no human error out of simple fatigue and just being human. So in my mind, at the time, it was a win-win. So that's why I decided to do it. I don't think it made any difference on anyone being promoted, including me. So, at the very best, it's just a helpful tool for the person reviewing the package. It's one of those things that, again, like, if you are convinced it's a thing, if some other board member told you it was a big deal and that's your mentor and you want to take that advice, you go right ahead. It's not going to hurt you. It's not going to get you promoted over someone else. So let's leave it at that. All right. So the method, how do you submit your package? Okay. There's three main methods. First, the old fashioned way, you can just mail it. There's specific guidance on how to do this in the advancement manual and the nav admin. So don't staple anything. It just, that makes the great folks at Millington's job harder. Just put everything in order in an envelope that will protect it and ship it to the address on the nav admin to the correct board number for which you are being considered. It's all in the nav admin. And the nav admin also specifically discourages certified mail as it can delay shipping. It can take longer, right? And you don't want your package to be late. So just regular mail, send it in. If you don't like that because, oh my God, it might get lost in the mail, encrypted email is next up. This is the way I've generally done it, is electronically. I like it better and I can get a positive response, which I'll talk about in a minute. So you can scan it and email it, and it needs to be encrypted, obviously, because there's PII all over this thing. Personally identifiable information, in case anybody didn't know what that acronym meant. So there are literally paid employees in Millington removing your paper copies, scanning them in, and then shredding them. Okay, those originals aren't going anywhere except into a shredder. So, why not save the paper and save them a little work? You can email it to CSCSELBOARD, B-O-A-R-D. Okay, so CSCSELBOARD at navy.mil. That address is in the nav admin as well, in case you don't trust my enunciation or pronunciation of it. But you must have the ability to encrypt it. And if you can't encrypt it, there's a service that's free to you and it CAC required, and it's called AMRDEC, however you want to pronounce it. It's AMRDEC. If you Google Army Safe File Exchange or AMRDEC, it'll be the first thing that pops up. Okay, so the Army Safe File Exchange. It can be found online. Like I said, just Google it. I'm not going to try to spell out this URL, but it'll be in the outline, just like all the other websites and locations for everything else I talked about. This service requires a CAC login, but will walk you through uploading your file, which is your scanned package, and then how to send a secure email. And it will even give you the option of having them, the service, email you when the package is downloaded. So that's the warm fuzzy I liked when I would attach my file because I couldn't encrypt email from my last command. I would attach the file and then send the email, and I could check that option so that when they downloaded it in Millington, I got this little email saying your file has been downloaded, and that made me, okay, I felt good because they have my package and they downloaded it, and I'm good to go. Okay, so those are the three methods. Any confusion about that, the nav admin will clear it up or ask your personnel people for help, okay? All right, so that's what I've got for your letter to the board for your chief's package, okay? The last part of this, I'm really excited that I got this information. A mentor of mine, he was my CMC or my COB on the submarine I made chief on. Amazing guy. And he sat both the chief's board and the senior chief's board. And he provided me with some information that I'm going to read verbatim. If you download the outline, it will be in there as well. Any little italics are just, I clarified it a little bit. Added a little information, just very tiny bits to provide some context of what he was saying, but I'm going to read this verbatim because it's just, it's great the way it is. And I hope this is helpful and insightful for you, kind of pulling the shroud back just a little bit, because a lot of it is kind of kept secret for a reason. But we'll pull the curtain back just a touch and clarify things a little bit. So this is me reading the board member information from Command Master Chief Submarines Retired, that sat both the Chiefs board and the Senior Chiefs board. At best, we grade about 20 to 25 records a day. We work 12 hours a day, 6 days a week, at least at the beginning. If you know someone whose package you're reviewing, but do not think you can be objective, you do not grade their record. If you know someone and have adverse information about them that is not in their record, you cannot say anything or you will be disciplined. You will be in deep trouble. If you know them and can clarify good points, you are allowed to add that information. If a package is sent to the board, it is scanned into what's called EMPRS, Electronic Military Personnel Record System. It's just the system that they use in Millington to conduct the board. It's what they're scanning everything into. If you send a package, it has to be reviewed. If you send the information, do not worry so much about quote unquote pissing off the board. If it is pertinent, the board will review it. Review your INCEPs and PSR to look for any gaps in eval data. I have seen a missing eval cause a sailor to not get selected. While the board looks at your entire record, the last 5 years of evals are what count. A missing eval 10 years ago will not make a difference in a sailor selection. Go back 6 years to be safe. It's for that tiebreaker thing we were talking about. If an award is missing on your PSR, but we find it in your OMPF or your record, we count it. If an award is missing on your PSR and your record, but you send it to the board, we count it. If a qualification is not in your record, but we find it in an eval, we count it. If you include a certified copy of your page 4 with the qualification listed, we count it. Things to include in your package if not already in your OMPF. Awards, so Navy Achievement Medals, Navy Commendation Medals, Sailor of the Quarter, Sailor of the Year, include copies of the certificate. Copy of a diploma or certificate for education. Last 5 years of evaluations, again, if not already in your own PF, especially if you transferred. Transfer evals are notorious for not getting entered in your record. And then page 4s with qualification or education data, not generally updated in your OMPF, so you want to get the most current copy from INCEPS, generate the report, and then submit that with your package. I do not think a career summary letter really makes any difference. We can read your evals and a PSR to get a pretty good idea of who you are and where you've been. Now on to how the board works. So grading. The board decides attributes to be graded. The scoring and point system is secret, but we determine what quals someone should have. And he's speaking from a submarine perspective, so he lists diving officer of the watch, chief of the watch, duty chief, senior in rate, etc. I included things for your surface folks, deck it, OOD, CDO. Not familiar with kind of aviation or CBs or other communities, but those, you guys know what those are. You ladies know what those are. So those kind of things I'm sure you're aware of. What collateral duties to grade, command career counselor, your analysis coordinator, CFL, SAPR, etc. We consider education and community service. Watch qualifications are going to count more than collateral duties and collaterals more than community service. Strength of recommendation for chief counts, and he's talking about block 43 in an eval. Do not have the recommendation removed to be replaced with recommended for officer programs if that's also a career goal that you have. The board wants to see the recommendation for chief. The officer programs will equate a great recommendation for chief with a great recommendation for the selection to an officer program. Plus, for CWO, LDO stuff, or any other officer programs, the commanding officer, the skipper, is allowed to write a separate letter, and that's the CO's endorsement, which is required for any officer programs application. Two people will grade your record according to the previously mentioned attributes. If they are 100 points apart, the two board members will discuss the differences, and it is normally resolved there. If they cannot resolve it, the record is given to two other members to grade. Deliberation. Once the records are graded, we find a natural break in the grading. If we are selecting 20 sailors, that line could be at sailor number 50. This list is then presented to the board president and approved. then deliberation or the murder board. The board members from that panel who graded your record will brief that individual, and we will vote one over the other for every record. Sailors move up and sailors move down as we determine who is the most qualified. This can be very heated of a process. Once we have our slate, we take it to the board president and brief our last select and the next three non-selects. If the president does not approve our slate, we go back to the previous process. If it is approved, that slate goes to the tank. Okay, so now the tank. Your panel briefs your selections, criteria, description of your rate, etc., to the other panels or the other rating panels. There's a secret electronic vote. If there is above a certain percent approval, your slate is approved and your recommendations for selection to chief are forwarded to NAVPERS. If not, you go back to the murder board process until you have your selectees. So that's the end of the input from the retired Command Master Chief on the board process, on what's considered for selection, on the package and everything. I hope that information was really helpful for you. So it's conclusion time. So we talked about what the Chief's package is and what it contains, the references governing that process, and then how to construct and submit your Chief's package. And then we got really amazing gouge from a retired Command Master Chief that has sat both the Chief's and Senior Chief's board. So we've covered pretty much everything there is to cover in this arena. And it's really important that you know the policy, you read the book, and then follow that guidance. That's how you, the board eligible sailor, gets selected by that board. That's how we make Chief. And that can be the difference. Taking the time to review your record, make sure everything's there, taking the time to understand the policy, to understand how a Chief's package is constructed, to do that correctly, to make sure that you submit everything correctly. The difference between a board package being considered and not considered could be a signature. So it's important that you take the time to read these references, to do that studying on your own. The people that do, the people that go line by line through this thing with a fine-tooth comb and highlight and write the margins and make sure they're checking every box, and then have chiefs and senior chiefs and master chiefs review their packages. I had a first class at my last command that found the board precepts, which are on the boards page, which is literally a debrief on what the board is looking for that selection board. And then he found the board membership list from that previous year, and he just cold called and emailed every board member, including the submarine guys, and he was a surface sailor, and asked them to review his package and for any tips or suggestions or advice that they had on how to improve his chances to be selected for chief. That is what I'm talking about. Okay, take the time to put the effort in. Take the time, put the effort in, review these references, go line by line through it, get all this information so that you're an expert on what this process is and how it works, so that you set yourself up for the best chance to succeed, for the best chance to get selected and to go through phase two and to pin on those anchors. There's no reason you shouldn't if you're fully qualified and you're the best of the fully qualified. And this process can be daunting, it can be confusing, it can be very intimidating, and there is a host of misinformation out there. I remember how confused I was, how many dumb questions I asked, and sometimes I got conflicting guidance from my chiefs and from other board eligible first classes. If you have questions about anything, please get a hold of me. I would even be happy to review chiefs packages as long as you're not sending me any personally identifiable information. I'd even be happy to do that. It's something I enjoy doing with the people that I work with in my command and anybody I'm mentoring. So if you have no other resource or you feel like you have no other resource, please hit me up. I'll do that. I'll answer questions. I'll point you to the resources. You know, I'll help you format your letter, whatever. But I encourage you also to seek out that help at your own command. There, I guarantee you, there is a senior listed human being at your command or near it that is just chomping at the bit to help people with this. So seek those people out. You'll know them when you see them. I'm confident that there's one in your area. If there's not, hit me up. I'm happy to do it. I hope this helped. Good luck to everybody out there. Again, if you need anything from us, you can Facebook message us. Don't Go Off the Ship podcast. You can direct message us on Instagram @dgutspodcast, or As always, you can email us, don'tgiveupthishippodcast@gmail.com. And that's all I got for this week for Chiefs Packages. Thanks for listening, and don't give up the ship.